Our text for today is taken from our gospel lesson. I read again verse 14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Here is the reading of our text. May God add his blessings to the reading of his word. Amen. We live in a dangerous world. When people say things like that, is it usually followed up with worries about things like nuclear war or global warming or an economic collapse or pandemic diseases or gun violence or some other such issue. Such things, though, are merely symptoms of the problem. The reality is far more dangerous and insidious. We live on the front lines of a spiritual struggle, and in America, we are losing. As concerned Americans cast about for solutions, and we all do that because even the most hardened atheist can see that we have these problems that are symptoms, as a nation, we often do the dumbest thing. We seek to use the enemy's tactics. We may think of it as fighting fire with fire, but in reality, what happens is that we get more and more entrenched in the enemy's mindset. That is to say, we are slowly converted to the enemy's side. Just to be absolutely clear, I'm talking about the war between the triune God and Satan. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit declared war way back in the Garden of Eden when he said enmity would exist between the Son, Jesus, and Satan. He also indicated that Satan would have his victories when he said that he would crush the heel of Jesus. But we were also told that the ultimate victory would be our Lord's when we are told that Jesus would crush the head of Satan. While the exact form of Satan's attacks have been modified over the centuries, the general approach remains remarkably consistent. We might call it the bait and switch tactic. Satan offers something grand, but when we bite, it turns out to be a disaster. So in the garden, Adam and Eve were offered an opportunity to be like God, a truly foolish offer that they believed. Satan still offers that same lie, and people still foolishly believe it. We are told that we are masters of our own fate. We can choose our own destiny. We are told that you can become your own God. We are told that we can be sinless. The results of such delusions is spiritual disaster, and often temporal disaster. In the end, every time we are tempted to think that we can do a better job than God, we are being tempted by the bait and switch approach of Satan. Churches, fearing their decline in numbers, look to business models or entertainment models or sociological models or other places seeking to boost their numbers. Sometimes, such approaches actually do increase the size of physical churches that use them. So smaller churches, looking with envy upon these mega churches, copy their growth models. No one ever seems to notice that Jesus never urges us to use such techniques. No one ever notices that the gospel is never spoken of. No one ever even notices that the Trinity seems to get forgotten. Just to be clear, I'm not saying that we can't use such models. We can. But they must always be submissive to the gospel. So, when a sociological model encourages us to be inclusive by ignoring doctrine, after all, the church is for all people, right? We should be inclusive. The sociological model that urges inclusiveness at the expense of doctrine is wrong and should give ground to Christian doctrines like the Trinity, the incarnation of Christ, the atoning death of Jesus, the return of Jesus, the sanctifying work of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, the saving nature of baptism, the blessings of the Lord's Supper, the central place of the Holy Spirit in working our salvation, the teachings confessed in the Nicene, Luther's Small Catechism, and so on, must always be maintained and proclaimed. Not just not denied, but proclaimed. If we lose such core teachings, we lose our identity as the people of God, the body of Christ, Christians. We are lured over to the camp of the enemy and often don't even realize it. If you are not hearing about justification by grace through faith in Jesus on Sunday morning, you are not in a Christian church. One of the things I truly treasure about the historic liturgy is that it ensures that we hear that message each week. We hear it in our confession of sins and the absolution or declaration of grace. We hear it in the confession of the ancient creeds like the Nicene and Apostles. We hear it when we receive the body and blood of Christ for our forgiveness. Because the hymns of our hymnal are carefully selected, we hear it in the songs that we sing. Even if I have a bad week as a preacher, and I know I'm only human, right? Some of my sermons are, shall we say, less than memorable. We still hear that we are sinners, justified by grace through faith in Jesus Christ because of our liturgy and our hymns. That's what I call a safety net, by the way. In our Old Testament lesson, the people of God were lured away from God. Satan used their corrupt desires to turn them from their faithful and loving Lord. Nothing new there. The fruit of their sin was poisonous snakes. The fruit of sin is always poisonous. Did the people try other solutions before they confessed their sins and received absolution? Moses really doesn't tell us. The text simply records that they recognized their sin, confessed, and received absolution in the form of an image that pointed to the crucified Jesus. Just as Jesus would be lifted up to become the cure for all humanity's sin, so Moses lifted up an image of death for the cure of the people. For Israel, the image of death, that is the serpent, became the death of their problem. So Jesus, in actual death, was raised on the pole of the cross to become the cure for our sin. Just as Moses instructed the people to look in faith to the image of death, so we look in faith to more than just an image. We look to him who died, we look to his death and discover forgiveness and life. Make no mistake, such stories as the one we find in our Old Testament lesson are recorded as a warning for us. Do not turn your back on Jesus. No matter what is being offered, forgiveness and life is found nowhere else and in no one else. Jesus is the Lord of life, and outside of him is only death and hell. Paul reminds us in our epistle lesson that apart from God's mercy in Christ, people are dead in their trespasses and sins. That is how we all began. So Paul tells us that we once walked in this way of death, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. These ways of the world never, ever lead to salvation. They never lead to eternal hope. They provide short victories, fleeting pleasures, and a false sense of security. In the end, their promises of self-worth and success vanish. If not before, then at least at the grave. No millionaire was ever able to take his bank account with him beyond that portal. Paul reminds us that in Christ we find the real answers to life, the answers to eternal life. So God has rescued us and seated us with Jesus in heavenly places. This will become manifest when we are transferred from this corrupt creation and into the perfect presence of the triune God. Even if you should gain the whole world, if you lose your soul, your life is an abject failure. You can tick off the great rich people in your mind and powerful people that went to a Christ-like grave. So often they're called the great, like Alexander the Great or something like that. Failures, each and every one who does not go to heaven, who do not know Jesus. So Paul warns us to remain faithful, cling to Christ, whom we find in word and sacrament. Our reading from John contains that oh so much loved Bible passage. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. What is often missed in the reading is the dangerous elements. Jesus singled it at first with his reference to our Old Testament passage where the people were perishing until they were saved. Only by returning to Jesus did they find the help they so desperately needed. We also notice that the world is spoken of by Jesus in this passage was in need of saving. It is a world filled with, so to speak, poisonous snakes. The text would make no sense if the world wasn't lost in sin, if the people were not in need of saving. It's kind of like a lifeguard at a beach. He's only really useful for the person who's drowning, right? He's not helping any of the people who are sunbathing. Notice that the passage does not say that God so loved the world that he gave instructions on how it is to save itself. Such instructions always come from the enemy's camp and are a death trap. God's solution is his intervention. He saves, he redeems, he justifies, he atones, he sanctifies, he, and he alone is our hope. The text teaches us that apart from Christ, we are condemned. Jesus, our loving Lord, said, "Whoever does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God." And this is judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light because their works were evil. Now, when you memorized John 3:16, did you go on and memorize those other verses as well? They're just not so warm and fuzzy, are they? But outside of Jesus, there's only condemnation. Being truly inclusive which God is, means that salvation is open to all in the name of Christ. But being truly inclusive is letting the light of Christ shine through us to all people. What Satan and the world call inclusive is the exact opposite of it. What the world calls inclusive is keeping people barred from the love of God because you're supposed to accept them as hellbound people and let them go there. That is not God's idea of inclusiveness. That is not Jesus' idea of inclusiveness. Jesus does not want to leave people hopelessly struggling against their sin. He wants to break their chains and bring them into everlasting life. The world's idea of inclusiveness leaves people chained to a failed world system. Will our country ever become Christian again? I don't know. What I do know is that our only hope is in the gospel. Of course, our country was never Christian, if by that you mean that it was the state religion, or that everyone in it was a Christian, or that the Bible was used as a book of law in our courts of law. But if by Christian you mean that the vast majority of Americans were in church on Sunday, then yes, we were once Christian. If by Christian you mean that the ideals of the Ten Commandments were being passed from one generation to the next, then yes, we were Christian. If by Christian you mean that the vast majority of Americans understood that there was a marked difference between the Christian faith and non-Christian faiths, then yes, there was a time when our nation was Christian. That time has passed as people drive by you with their coexist bumper sticker, which basically says, let people go to hell, and you shouldn't care about that. Bigger bombs, bigger housing projects, bigger national parks, bigger schools, bigger roads, and so forth, will not renew the soul. That is done only by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that is where we come in as the church. The government is and should be in charge of bombs and housing projects and state parks or national parks and so on. We are in charge of sharing the gospel. That is what God has put us here for. God has put the government here for roads. God has put the government here for armies. God has put the government here for all those sorts of things. He has put us here to share the gospel. We are to hold fast to biblically revealed truth, stand up for it, and share it. God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. We are told by Paul that we are the body of Christ, the very Son that God sent into the world because he loves it. The Son who brings light and life into the world is still here then. He is here in us, his body. We are the ones who guide people away from the serpents and to Christ, just as Moses did in our Old Testament text. We are the ones that call people out of darkness, the darkness of the world, and into the marvelous light of Christ. God loves the world so much that he has placed us, the body of Christ, in the midst of these dangerous times, right here, to lead people to Jesus, to share the light of God in these dangerous times. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.